Howdy. This is another Saturday dance class. We've had a couple of pleasant days here. 2 days when it's been 50 or so. And of course, for Saturday, it got real cold and there was a layer of snow on the ground. That's how it always is when we come here. And before it was winter time, every Saturday morning when we came here, it was rainy. Well, there have been maybe a couple of good Saturdays, but most of the time the weather has been uncannily vengeful, at least compared to like what it was the day before. That's how it goes, though. I sometimes wonder. Damn it. If people hate themselves enough. Personally, I could never hate myself too much. Now, there are some complex factors that go into that. It's partially based on life experience, but it's also logical deduction. You want to take it from the macro going into the micro. We represent a species that has great evil to it, that has done all sorts of nasty things to the earth. People call it an ideal when you say, oh, things could have been this way. Well, if we had evolved a little differently, things would have been so much better. But look at the way we evolved. Look at the inefficient manner. I mean, people keep talking about how elegant human anatomy is, and how graceful the human body is. I mean, that's one of the reasons why I could never really be an artist, to buy into this gracefulness. Even if I want to portray it in a state of wretchedness, I still have to learn about the gracefulness of it in order to do that. Just like if you're a musician, if you want to play bad, you have to learn how to play good first before you can really be accepted to play bad. So, as we go through life, are we humble enough? We could call it that. Do we have enough humility? Oftentimes, it's pride that really screws things up for us, that kicks us in the ass, that gets in the way so many times. And, you know the saying, nice guys finish last and all that bullshit? Well, sure, nice guys can finish last. They don't always finish last. If we could focus some of our pride into having a humble kind of satisfaction, I think we would all do much better. And in simple terms, you know, I think sweeping concepts are often involved when you throw around words like humility and pride and being humble and shit like that. But it's much easier to understand hate, right? And we project hate a lot. I hate this, I hate that, you know. This kind of music sucks. I hate that food, I don't want to have that for supper. Shit like that. When we really should be giving equal time, at least, you know, just like political candidates get equal time, we should be giving equal time to project some of that hate inward. Now, you run the risk of it manifesting in some actual physical harm, because people don't know how to diffuse that. People don't know how to filter that. When they focus it inward, it's almost like there has to be a reaction within the physical realm, right? I hate myself, therefore I'm going to drink half a bottle of scotch or die trying, right? No. That's the easy way out, man. You hate yourself, you carry that hatred with you. You don't do something that makes it go away. What the hell kind of pussy move is that? I haven't gotten drunk in months. You carry that hatred of yourself with you. You let it grow. You let it fester. You let it whisper things to you. You let it keep you up at night, telling you crazy shit. That's how you learn. Who says life is supposed to be a numb party, man? Nobody told me that. You know, as you get older, you appreciate little bits of twisted philosophy. And this is one of them, right? I try to preach this to the wrong audience, and it's going to get spit back in my face. But if you think about it, hating yourself is really a key to loving the world. If you can recognize the faults within yourself, if you can see your shortcomings, if you can flagellate yourself mentally because of those shortcomings, and to do it in a way that doesn't seek out numbness, that doesn't seek out forgiveness, okay? Fuck forgiveness, people. It's all hype, okay? Forgiveness is all hype. You have to keep on hating yourself, I think. I hate myself every day. Many points throughout the day, I'm reminded of how much I hate myself. And if a day comes when I'm pleased as punch with everything about myself, please throw me down a flight of fucking stairs, okay? It's not healthy to be fucking tickled pink with yourself. All these books are wrong, to the best of my estimation. Because when you try to incorporate that, I'm okay, you're okay, the world is fine, let's only look at the bright side type of stuff, you're setting yourself up to get bit in the ass big time and repeatedly down the road. Just get tackled by the dog side of life and have it maul you. It's not really the way to go. So as a result, you have to make spaces for all the bad stuff, and that includes self-hatred. And if you don't make spaces for the bad stuff, it tends to make spaces for itself. Spaces where you might not necessarily want to have it as much, you know what I'm saying? So yes, I'm not sure we hate ourselves enough. Case in point. Old example. This thing's 21 years old. When I was in China, I spent a month in China, and we did a lot of homestays. Stayed in villages, stayed in yurts in Mongolia, things like that. There were hotels involved too, but there were also homestays. So, the group I'm with, a bunch of privileged students from Massachusetts, you know, get to China. Not just like the first day, not just the first week or anything like that, but throughout the trip, for the most part, the vast majority of kids who were there, when I say kids, talking about 18-year-old kids, vast majority of kids who were there still tended to look down and, you know, oh, look at these poor conditions, look at the way they live, look, fuck, man, we don't understand so much about the world around us, and yet we have these attitudes that we convey, that we portray. We live up to these stereotypes that do us harm in the long run. To have a world view is to be humble, to be a humble traveler, to not expect too much, to not ask for too much, to be respectful and polite no matter where you go. And Americans have this idea that wherever they go, it's a fucking vacation, right? It's party time. It's drinks at the cabanas. And it's so disgusting. We don't realize it. Mention vacation to an American, and they think, oh, I'm going to kick back and relax and spend money and have people wait on me. They won't put it in those words, but you watch what happens, right? They book their little cruises, they book their plane flights, they go over to Europe, they go over to, you know what I'm saying? And they're waited on, and they eat out, and all this shit. Man, H.P. Lovecraft, the great author of supernatural horror stories and other types of weird fiction, when he traveled, and he enjoyed traveling, he would pack a suitcase with cans of tinned food, you know, crackers, sardines in a can, stuff like that. He traveled by bus, traveled by train. He went down to New Orleans. Now, this is the guy who's known for being a Rhode Islander, although he was in Brooklyn for a while. And that's how he traveled frugally, on a writer's budget. That's how you see the world. Too many times, we allow ourselves that luxury upgrade that is detrimental in the long run. One of the biggest American outrages I've ever seen happened on that China trip. We're at the train station, and it's going to be a long train ride, an overnight train, so there's sleeper cabins in the train. Little, you know, tiny, I think four persons to a room type sleeper cabins with these cots built into the wall. Old-fashioned trains. Think of American trains, you know, in the 50s and stuff like that. Well, that was the equivalent. Luggage is separate, it's loaded separate, or you meet up with it while you're on board, or some shit like that, I forget. So, we're in one of these cabins, and the kid who has the bunk above me, he says, you smell shit? And I paused, and I smelled, and I said, yeah, I kind of smell shit. It wasn't something I was focusing on, you know? And then all of a sudden, he freaks, and he said, there's shit on my sheets. And I'm thinking, no, shit on your sheets, man. And he shows there's shit on his sheets. And then he's opened his suitcase, right? And he's moved some stuff around. And he can't figure out, there's shit on stuff that was in his suitcase. And then the final coup de grace freak out, there's shit on me! What happened was, while we were on the boarding platform, his suitcase was placed in a pile of shit, and that got taken into the train. Americans don't expect to see piles of shit near boarding platforms, but we weren't in America, we were on the other side of the world. Agrarian society. You got fields next to the train platforms, you got animals, you got cows. Don't ask me how it ended up on the train platform, but it did. We just don't watch for stuff like that. We don't expect stuff like that. And because we have not acclimated our minds to be vigilant about stuff like that and to accept stuff like that, we experience such fucking outrage. And he complained up and down, left and right, that the porters had handled his bags and thrown them in shit or some ridiculous stuff like that, making an ass, a total ass out of himself. Imagine. Imagine how we would feel if somebody came in front of us with shit all over themselves, claiming that we're the ones who are responsible for it, right? Had to get one of the supposed group leaders out of a very scary jam. This motherfucker brings along American flag pins, like they're the greatest fucking thing, like the missionaries think they're gonna save everybody. This guy starts passing out American flag pins, and the Chinese are very polite. They accept it, xie xie, thank you, bekachi, whatever. But on this train, we happen to be in the company of some Mongolians. And there's a cook in the kitchen that must be almost 7 feet tall, built like Jaws from the James Bond movies, you know what I'm saying? And here is this supposed team leader, right? His name was Jack. He must have been 50 years old or so. Trying to pass out American flag pins to these almost Soviet bloc Mongolians and passing them out like he's doing them a favor, practically. Like, they're wonderful and he's giving them some sort of government aid. You know what I'm saying? And so, they're just getting more pissed off by the minute. And I happen to wander into the dining compartment, and I found him like sitting at a table, sweating fucking bullets, with three Mongolians around him. One of them is as big as a house, and they're all looking at him really mean. So, we happen to be having arm wrestling contests in the cabin in back of us, and so here I was, 170 pounds at the time. I decide to defuse the situation by challenging the 7-foot-tall Mongolian to an arm wrestling contest, right? And he was pleased as punch. He was amused. And so he had me, but he didn't put me down, right? He wanted me to struggle. He really wanted me to struggle against him. So finally, what I did that he never expected. This is what he would never expect from an American. As we have our arms locked, I pull his arm so he pins me. You should have seen the fucking look on his face. Last thing in the world. He expected the American to struggle like a worm on a hook until he toyed with him to the point of boredom, and then he would have pinned me. But I pinned my fucking self. That totally diffused the situation. After that, they were pretty cool. But too many times, just like with that example, we carry the wrong attitudes with us. We carry them forward into our day. And it doesn't have to be some big example of when you're on vacation in another country. Just when you're in somebody's house. When you're crossing the fucking street. The attitudes we have direct impact on the people around us. Supposedly, we're these social animals, right? But we're broken. We're twisted, broken social animals. People think that they do well. Well, I'll tell you, most of the time, these supposedly well-adjusted social people do well because they found a clique, they found a niche, they found a group that thinks the way they do. It's not the high, holy fucking blessing from heaven. It's the fact that they've surrounded themselves with people who will nod their heads in agreement to the belief system that they have. Not necessarily the answer, you know what I'm saying? It's a great kind of celery, by the way, Vanessa celery. See, I'm a fucking doof. So I have problems, right? One of my problems is being in social situations, because I have a difficult time getting any slight receptive senses that people are on any similar frequency, any similar wavelength that I might have. So it's always a constant process of adjusting. And it's not pleasant. Adjusting to the typical atmosphere that's in a large social situation sort of like boils down to the lowest common denominator, in a sense. And it's frustrating, and it's ugly, and I'm not